bypasses. There's some that are constantly being developed all the time. I say constantly, that will exist at some point in time. And a great defense to that is you have the ability to block binaries that are known to bypass device guard. If you don't trust that application anymore, just say that you don't, build it into what we call a code, or what is deemed a code integrity policy, and your system will not be allowed to run it. We'll get into this in a little bit with an example. Matt Graber is curating a, kind of like a baseline code integrity policy, you could say, which contains different binaries that are known to be misused by attackers to bypass device guard and the protections that it has in place. So if you need like a single place to start, like if you want something, just need to know where to go, that's a great first start on, hey, I don't know exactly what I want to allow yet, but I know that I should block these. So a code integrity policy is how you define applications that are trusted. And so this can be through a variety of different techniques or a variety of different methods of defining what you trust, which I'll get into in a second. And code integrity policies can be deployed through GPL. And I don't know if I've seen a ton of documentation on it yet, but the goal is also through SCCM as well. Code integrity policies are largely based on digital signatures. If you digitally sign your applications, maybe that you develop internally, or if you use software that is signed by some third-party authority or something like that, then it's going to make your life a lot easier when it comes to managing code integrity policies, because you can manage trust and what you trust through your policy significantly easier than if you use the unsigned applications. Unsigned applications, in order to trust those, you can create basically like catalog files and then roll those up essentially into your code integrity policy. And you'll say, I want to trust this application and allow it. The problem with catalog files is that anytime an application is updated, you will need to generate a new catalog file. And so this can, I mean, you can, I'm sure, already imagine the potential for administrative work or overhead if you have a lot of these applications in your throughout your environment. Code integrity policies themselves are typically, are XML, excuse me, and then they're converted from XML to binary. And the Microsoft or Windows 10 or Server 2016 basically interprets and reads the binary and parses it and uses that to make trust decisions within the operating system, excuse me. Another good thing about it is code integrity policies themselves can be changed. It's not gonna do you any good if you don't sign your code integrity policies and an attacker gets admin on the box and then just says, hey, just trust everything, or maybe trust everything I write. It would serve no purpose then. So if you can sign your code integrity policies to ensure that they're not gonna be modified, and it's a kind of a quick win to try to help mitigate that attack vector. All right, so I know I keep talking about code integrity policies, what they are, what you can do with them. There's a couple really easy ways to create them. Matt Graber and Carlos Perez have two different guides, which I link to right here, on how to quickly just get up and started and create a code integrity policy just to get started. By the way, all of these slides have been released. It's all online, so don't stress out if you can't see this, any of these links or anything, because you can just download them and you'll be able to go to it right there. The easiest way to create a code integrity policy is you'll use a PowerShell commandlet called newtacci-policy. When you do this, the PowerShell essentially will scan your system at a point that you specify, whether this be the root of C, whether you're creating like a volume shadow copy and you're scanning from that. And it will start creating a code integrity policy. The granularity of how definitive it is and the types of checks that it makes before making a trust decision are based on how you define this code integrity policy scan. So there's a bunch of different levels. This is not all inclusive, but you can say, hey, I only want to trust applications based off of the file hash maybe that I'm making from the system that I'm scanning. So it's a great way if you know your binaries on your system aren't ever going to change. The problem when something is updated in that case, obviously, it's not going to run. You can also do it by file name, publisher, file publisher, PCA certificate, LEAF certificate. There's a couple different ways that you can just choose where you want to put your trust. And so this is an example of a code integrity policy. This is a very minor snippet of one, but this is XML, and it's basically saying that this is actually kind of a cool little trick where these are some of the binaries that are known to include, or known to be used for bypassing device guard. So the one thing with device guard is, or code integrity policies, is you don't generally define something that you like blacklist. It's either just something that you trust or it's not run. But what if you, let's say, trust all of Microsoft signed binaries, so everything that's stock out of the box on a Windows system, and then they develop a new bypass is developed for device guard. Well, the cool trick that he's doing here, or Matt and the curators of this list, are basically defining a minimum file version. So let's talk MS Build. MS Build is a great example for bypassing device guard. However, it's not currently at the 999.999.999 version. And so what is being specified in here, in this specific line, is saying, hey, only allow MS Build to run if it is that version. Since it's not currently that version, that binary will not be allowed to run. It would be blocked. So once you've created an XML file containing your code integrity policy, the next process is to convert it from the XML into that binary file that I was talking about. Once you have that, that's basically what your system needs, because then it can immediately parse that and start trying to enforce device guard. So one of the cool things that you can do with it is you can say, hey, don't automatically just start blocking all these binaries or drivers or anything like that. Only run in audit mode. And so this is kind of the way that we like to promote when developing code integrity policies for systems, is that don't just immediately start enforcing your code integrity policy, because chances are you might have missed something that maybe someone in your business needs, or there is a business need somewhere. And if you enforce your policy, it's gonna block them and nothing will be able to get done. However, if you do it in audit mode, it will create a device guard will create an event in the Windows event log that says, hey, this binary was attempted to run on this system. It should have been blocked on, or due to my device guard policy configuration that I received. However, because it's only in audit mode, we're just generating an alert, essentially. You can then look at that, look at the different events that have been created, and figure out, okay, do I actually trust any of these applications that normally would have been blocked, but should have been allowed to run? And if so, maybe let's go ahead and revise that code integrity policy to allow them to run. After you make any modifications like that, then you can just deploy it in enforcement mode and actually start enforcing your code integrity policy. And this will start blocking untrusted binaries on your system. And we'll have an example in just a second. The other thing that Device Guard does is it auto-enrolls PowerShell into constrained language mode. If you're an attacker, constrained language mode is generally not your friend. A good way to think of what constrained language mode is pure PowerShell commandlets are allowed, largely speaking, except for a few blacklisted ones. However, a lot of .NET methods are restricted to those, except a very like whitelisted type, so maybe like date, time, and 32, or a variety of other ones. So it really locks down PowerShell where you don't have access to a lot of the same function calls or anything that you might want to do that attackers do currently to compromise their system. All right, so let's give just a kind of a quick little demo of what this may look like. All right, so this is obviously a Windows 10 system. I created a code integrity policy on the system a little while ago, and I already had Google Chrome on here when I scanned the system. So if I run this and I said that I trusted this, Google is obviously allowed to run because it is trusted when I created my policy. However, one thing that I didn't have on here is PuTTY. And so PuTTY is just a binary that was not there. It would not have been picked up on my code integrity policy scan. And so if I try to run this, this is what you're gonna see. You see something like this where your organization used device guard to block this application. and so forth. Just an error message, essentially not allowing this to run. Like one thing that you can, if there's one thing that you, I really almost want people to take away is, short of implementing some sort of a bypass, like DeviceGuard can really kind of eliminate a class of malware where you don't have attackers that can really just drop custom compiled code on any of your systems anymore. You can, if they are able to determine and review your code integrity policy, they can maybe look at like your chain of trust and figure out, hey, maybe if we pop the CA or this intermediate that we trust, or if they're able to come up with a collision of some sort, if you're doing it on like the hash level, then they can try to exploit it that way. But just someone coming up and just dropping MSF Venom executable on your system, trying to get Meterpreter calling back to them, is not going to work, and they're going to run exactly into the same problem. Thank you.
So from an attacker's perspective, look into or something like applications that are native to Windows. So these are like application whitelisting bypasses. Examples could be like WMI or PowerShell. So can these be chained together to create a post-exploitation framework or techniques to bypass DeviceGuard, but not really bypass, but more operate within the constraints of DeviceGuard and constrained language mode? So that's why we developed WMI Implant. So WMI Implant's a tool that actually allows you to operate fully within the constraints of DeviceGuard. So as he said with his code integrity policies, you can whitelist applications. You can't necessarily blacklist them, but with the version numbers, you can whitelist different types of binaries, which you can also make sure that other binaries, like MS Build, for example, is blocked. So you'd have to kind of craft different
code integrity policies to ensure that everything works. But with WMI, it's actually almost impossible to do that because it's used so much natively within a domain network. So with our framework and WMI Implant, you can actually do everything that you need. It has its own C2 channel. It does data storage. It has triggers and mechanisms that allow you to pretty much operate in everything. So let me give you a shout out to Matt Graber, Willie Valentine, and Claudio, who did all the research on WMI. They essentially allows us to perform these attacks. So what is WMI? Essentially, it's a management utility in Windows that has been around since Windows 2000. And sysadmins always use this, and also things that you may not even know, like SCCM or WSUS, to push out packages, push out things, pull back data, things like that, and remotely communicate with a lot of different systems on your network. So with WMI Implant, it is a purist tool that only uses WMI. You may see other tools that claim to be using WMI all the time, but sometimes to get data back, which has been the biggest issue that we've encountered, you know, they may have to stand up an HTTP server, an HTTPS server, and have that implant post back to that server to get output. With this utility, it is purist. Everything that it does in terms of sending and receiving is all done via WMI. And you have the full capability of doing everything you would need for post-exploitation. So, and again, it operates within constrained language mode. So data storage and encoding were problems initially. And this was because how do we upload, download, and get output back, assuming that, you know, some of this data is going to be very large. And again, everything within WMI. So we may have to manipulate this text to get it back in a proper manner. So we discovered that encoding within constrained language mode could be an issue. So that's something I want to talk about right now, is how did we get encoding working within constrained language mode? One would think, why don't you just call the 2Base64 string method within PowerShell, but it doesn't work within constrained language mode. So then we thought, well, what can we do? This is a problem. So is there a pure PowerShell Base64 encoding capability out there? We couldn't really find one, and we didn't really want to build one ourselves. So our good friend and coworker Daniel Bohannon thought of this really cool idea, which has actually been around for a long time, but we implemented it into a WIMI implant, which was essentially to just take a string of data. In this case, it would be input. We would cast it to a character array. So let's just take, for example, the string hello, and it would be a character array, H-E-L-L-O, obviously like five characters or whatever within that array. And then that would be casted to an integer value. So it would take the integer value of that character. So now you just have a string. Technically, it's not a string at this point. It's just an integer array of digits that would represent an actual string. And that in itself is encoding, technically, because it's just, it's not the full actual string array. So we thought, huh, this is kind of cool. So this is what it would look like in, you know, in actual, for this specific string, it would look like this integer array that, again, represents this exact string. So we can store this easily anywhere we want, and it's in a format that could be easily decoded on the other side.
The nice thing about using this is, actually, there's only one modification required, but we can use this for binary files as well. So this isn't just text. If we want to upload a picture or an executable, something that we need to maintain the integrity of the file itself, all we're doing is changing it from an array of chars to an array of bytes. And we're able to have the same capabilities and completely perform upload and downloads through that way.
So initially, we thought, well, where are we going to store this array or this data, for example? And we thought, well, the registry seems like a pretty good place. Why don't we do that? Because we can store anything in the registry, and it allows us to do it in a large size. So that was what we did on the initial version of WIMI Implant. And we can easily modify, create keys. We can create random keys and random values. We can store up to whatever we want. And you can use WMI to query the registry to pull that data back using the standard RegProv class within WMI. But one of the issues with the registry is it does leave a lot of evidence behind for investigators to find.
Thank you.
So he's going to talk about that.
Yeah, so that's, and there's, basically what he said is there could be potential size limitations, we're not limited to it to a very small size when using the registry. There are lots of parsers out there. Like the registry is what a lot of different tools look for malicious activity. Hey, there's this weird key creation going on in the system. Like what's going on? Maybe you don't necessarily invoke the IR team immediately, but it's probably something worth raising some sort of alarm. So registry is an option, but wasn't our immediate choice. And after talking this through with a couple of coworkers, I was specifically talking with Matt Dunwoody, and he brought up APT29. And he's like, APT29 was this pretty nifty group that creates custom WMI classes and then shove data within properties of that class. And that's how they were, that's what they were using for data storage. And so, like that sounds like a pretty nifty idea. We kind of remove this registry requirement. So let's see if we can actually go ahead and recreate this. And lucky for us, Matt Graber published code that lets us do this. So I had a complete working proof of concept right here, which allows us to, hey, let's create this class called Evil Class. Let's put it there and actually get it on the system. Then let's attempt to add a property to it of whatever name with whatever value, and place it in that WMI class. However, we tried this, and we discovered that there was a problem. So what you're seeing here is we are creating the class, the WMI class, Win32 Evil class, and putting it on the system, and that works. It works. The problem comes when we were actually trying to add a property to the custom WMI class that we created, and that was actually blocked via constrained language mode. This was like the weirdest thing in the world to me, because I really thought that within either device guard or constrained language mode, that if I'm allowed to create a custom WMI class, I probably would be able to create a property. But that's not the case at all. So we were kind of down in the dumps because we didn't think that this was going to work, unless we thought about what if we can repurpose maybe an existing WMI class that already is on the system. The way that we kind of tried to figure out, okay, we have a couple different requirements. First of all, it would need to be a writable property, obviously. It would need to be a string type. We obviously can't just store a random string in a something requiring or expecting an integer. We can the property be modified in the constrained language mode? Because at this point, we had no idea. And can we actually change this WMI property and it won't just trash the box and blue screen it and bring everything down? So this is something that we wanted to investigate and try to figure out if it was possible. And so I found this existing script that just did some basic WMI property enumeration. And I extended it a little bit to enumerate all WMI classes, find all properties within each class, and then find every property that is of data type string that is also writable that we can modify. And there's, in case anyone wants to recreate this, there's the link to the script right there. And we got some. I got some results. However, this returned a somewhat limited number of properties, so it wasn't a giant list. We didn't have a ton that we could really work with. Some of them, oddly enough, only allowed a fixed, or I guess not necessarily oddly enough, but only allowed a small fixed length of data. So it wasn't something that we could really use for C2 or any sort of data storage purposes. Others really gave this odd errors when attempting to modify, and it would just be like generic failure or generic error. It wasn't something I felt we could really debug because we had no extra information or any verbose messages that would help us try to figure out, okay, what's wrong with this. However, this did lead us to identify a class that I had not seen before and I had not interacted with, which is the Win32 OS Recovery Configuration class. And so what this class does is this is the class that specifies the type of information that is collected when your system crashes. So when you get a blue screen on it, it will that's where it says, hey, we're doing a memory dump to this location. That's when this class is invoked. And so here's actually a representation of the object. There are other attributes here that aren't shown, excuse me, but you have like a debug file path. You have a name, just some extra information. And so that's what is shown when you just pull that object back. What we found that there is a single property that we tested at that time, which is writable, and it's a string. And it's that debug file path property. And that's the path that, again, when your computer blue screens, that actually tells it, hey, where to place that memory dump. And so that's this one. So this is saying just system root / memory dump. So it's kind of cool because it looks like, I thought we had an option, but our problem was it looks like this should only accept a file path. Like this is probably validated by the OS upon submission or something like that. And even if we could just put in an arbitrary string, we also thought, well, hey, this might also be limited in length. And so that's what it looks like. And so we decided to test that. And so what you see here is us validating that we are running in constrained language mode. We are pulling back that Win32 OS recovery configuration class. We're setting the debug file path to the string all your base are belong to us and storing it on the system and or placing it. And it took. And so to validate, we pulled it back or we pulled a new instance of that object. And what do you know? We actually have that string right here. So it worked. So it's awesome because that's a really cool idea. It showed that we actually can write arbitrary strings to the debug file path without performing any sort of file or directory validation to make sure it's something that exists. So with that, we've learned our encoder that we're using for storing or for encoding data, whether that be binary or text, should work. The only thing that we have to come up with and figure out, like, what about length? Like, that's going to be our main limiter. Well, that was what we tested next. So we pulled that or used that same instance of that object. We have all your base are belong to us. We're then multiplying that by basically a million, putting it back down and storing that property. We're then now out, what's going down here is we're taking the output of that property, storing it to a file, and just in this sample, we've got 57.2 megs of data storage in this WMI property. So this is everything that we needed. This is a writable string property, writable in constrained language mode. It doesn't blue screen the box when we modify it, and it's not fixed in length. Right here we say I've actually gotten it up to 256 megs. I think I've gotten it close to a gig on systems with larger memory capacity where we're able to just dump data in it and it doesn't kill the machine at all. So with this, we were able to figure out our C2 methodology, how we can repurpose this. So let's say if we're now using anything within our tool that requires data storage, the first thing that our tool does on the remote machine is let's query the original debug file path property. Let's get that original value. We can then use WMI to execute a command on the remote system. So this may be, in this case, ipconfig. Those results from it are then encoded using that constrained language mode compliant encoder and stored on that remote system's debug file path property. Once we have that, we make another query from our system to actually get that value back, return it to us, the attacker, decode it, and display its results to the console. Once we have that, then we just set the debug file path property back to its original value, and depending upon the command that you're issuing, this all takes place in like a manner of 2 seconds, 5 seconds. It really just depends what you're doing. So it's very, very fast. So almost all of WIMI Implant's C2 commands actually don't require data storage. So we don't need to go through this process. The nice thing is we're just immediately able to receive the results that we want and parse them out through some means. But in the event that the command that we're running, and we'll demo a couple, actually do require data storage before we can retrieve the results, this is the exact methodology that we followed.
So now we're going to kind of talk about...
Not going to make that mistake again. So we'll talk about some of the commands within WIMI Implant and kind of explain how it works so you can use it on your own. So it's broken up by a few things. It has different types of meta functions, file operations for lateral movement, essentially different phases of post-exploitation. And the meta functions include things like help, exit, change user, or you can generate a command line like string that you can just paste into a command. So here's an example of using GenCLI to actually get a full command. Why this is important is because if you're operating from a C2 backdoor, for example, and you only have command line access, interactive command lines with like an interactive menu is not necessarily something you can do. So if you just want to execute one command, like through Empire or Cobalt Strike or Meterpreter, you can do that by generating the command and just importing the module and then calling the command directly or the function. So it has both options. So some file operations, similar to like Linux, you can do an ls or a cat. It'll take that input and actually cat a remote file. It'll do ls, so a directory listing on a remote directory of your victim. And then NinjaCopy is pretty cool because it'll copy any file from the victim back to you. And then you can also search the file system for different things of importance. And there are more. These are just some examples of file operations. Here's an example of actually catting a remote file, in this case it's text.txt, on this specific victim remotely. One thing I do want to mention that's kind of cool is that we, on the back end of WIMI Implant, actually invoke some obfuscation in PowerShell to try to avoid logging command line arguments. So with Sysmon out there, like new detection capabilities that some of these endpoint technologies have, command line arguments of PowerShell are getting caught. So we like to obfuscate every single one of our commands remotely so it bypasses this detection. So it's also kind of a cool feature on the back end that you don't have to worry about. And in this case, it cats the file, it comes back with that output. In this example, it uses what Trunster was talking about. It stored that data to the WMI property, remotely queried for that property, and pulled back the data to you, again, using pure WMI.
To kind of give like a walkthrough on what Evan was talking about with this being obfuscation is, so this is verbose information. You're not normally seeing this. This is largely for this presentation. You can enable this if you actually want to see from an attacker's perspective what you're doing, but we're actually just creating a random environmental variable, which is that TWRYI up there, and then the value of that variable is your actual command. So that's where you see the git content encoding, so it's reading in the file, it's encoding it, and then storing it in the registry. And so what's actually run on the command line, if you were performing some sort of command line auditing, is you're not seeing any of that. All you're seeing is that PowerShell child item pulling back that environmental variable, getting its value, and then executing it on its system. And that's all that would actually be audited.
So here's another example of us just searching for a specific file. You can either do file extension or you can do an actual file. In this case, I'm searching for the string WIMI implant within this within the C drive of this specific victim. And it will essentially go through the whole file system for any file with the name WIMI implant in it. And it comes back for files. So this could be useful if you're looking for password files, SQL files, configuration files, anything that may store some sort of password or something that may be useful for you for post-exploitation or additional lateral movement and privilege escalation. So file uploads and downloads. These are, you know, if you want to bring down a file, let's say, for example, this link file is something you're of interest. Now you have the full path to that link file so you can remotely download it from that system and pull it back. So that's kind of, again, for a full RAT, you would want these sort of capabilities, kind of like you would with Meterpreter, Empire, Beacon, things like that. So we had, what we don't know are what type of files you can bring back. If you're trying to pull back gigabytes of files or just megabytes of files, we don't really know that. That's up to the user's discretion. So due to that limitation, we are still storing files in the registry because we have a huge amount of data. If we just create a register key, it's almost like an unlimited amount of data you could put in there depending on your disk space and how much you have left. And it does the same kind of thing that the WMI property does. It will take the original value or it will create a new key depending on how it was configured. It will read and encode the file to be uploaded. It will store it in that system's registry, and then it will start PowerShell in the remote system using WMI, read and decode that registry value, and then write the decoded results to your attacker system. So that's how we'll pull back, again, using pure WMI to remotely query the registry. Some lateral movement examples would be command exec, which essentially you can run an arbitrary command like the ipconfig command that he showed earlier on a remote system. Enable wdigest, this is actually really important. It sets this specific registry key on the remote system. By default, Windows 10 does not have this key even configured on the system. So if you actually run Mimikatz on a Windows 10 system, you will not get a clear text credential in memory. But if you create this key and enable it, it actually will have that value. So if you create this key, reboot the system, run Mimikatz, and Windows 10 systems will now have the clear text credential in memory. So if you're using our little implant here, you can remotely do that on systems, and then you can run Mimikatz as well using this remote POS script, which is another cool lateral movement function that you can use. So what that does is it allows you to remotely push a PowerShell script. It will execute that script and then pull back the data.
All in memory.
So let's say, for example, invoke Mimikatz is something that you want to remotely run on a, let's say, 100 systems or two systems, whatever you want. You can do that using remote POS, and it doesn't ever touch disk. So it's pretty clever, and again, it uses only WMI. And that data comes back within that WMI property, too. So good luck finding evidence of that running or any sort of output being sent or saved on the remote system. Pretty clever function, and I recommend y'all use it. Another example here is we're using this remote POS, the same one I just told you about, on this remote system, executing blah.ps1, which as you can see, essentially just outputs this test is for troopers. So we push this remote script to that system. We ran the function, which is Chris test, and as you can see, output comes back. This is, again, incredibly useful when you want to run like things like invoke Mimikatz or other PowerShell scripts for post-exploitation. So we're going to do a quick demo for you.
All right. We didn't record this, so we're just doing this live.
We're doing it live.
All right. Let's get the IP. All right. So I'm just going to run this in verbose mode. This is basically what it looks like. Kind of the menu. So there is an interactive menu. That's how it initially started off. But again, like we said, our main use case for this is going to likely be in a non-interactive manner. So this tool will completely generate the command line command that you would just issue, and you have complete functionality of the tool, obviously, without having to go into this interactive menu. So here's kind of the meta functions that Evan was talking about. These are just like
basic administrative tasks you might need of the tool. So right now, it's running in the context of my current user account. But let's say you compromise additional credentials and you want to authenticate as that user. You can just change user right here, and it will actually change. It'll create a new PS credential object, and it will change how you're authenticating to whatever system you're targeting. So let's just give an example. PS, so basic process listing. This is something that doesn't require WMI for data storage. We're just basically receiving the results back and immediately just parsing it out and displaying it to the console. So I'm just gonna run PS. I'm just gonna say go against my current machine, and there we go. So we're getting all the different results back from it. To get the commands again, we'll just get help. We can do a couple different things. So command exec, this is one thing. This is important where we can get that output. Process start is a command to just start a process, but that's kind of how I view WMI, is it's more like blind process execution. You don't get results, like you can't see anything if you're expecting something back from it. Command exec is different. This actually leverages WMI for data storage. So let's try it. We have command exec. I'm going to tell it to target my system, and I'm going to provide a command. So let's say ipconfig whack all. So you're going to see a blue screen pop up real quick. The reason for that is because I'm targeting this current system. When you run this remotely on a different system that you're targeting when you're operating in a domain, that's not going to show up. So you wouldn't see that. So I'm running it. It's getting the output. And it's pulling it right now. And there we go. We have results. And so the way that this is actually working is kind of like you said, is starting that tool or that command, issuing it on the system, encoding the results, storing it. But when we implant on my local attacker system, it doesn't just like sleep for 10 seconds and then tries to pull it and then fails. It's kind of like a polling where it'll check every so often to see if the script or command that it's running on the remote system is done. If it is, then pull back the results. Like what you see here is it wasn't done. So it slept for 5 more seconds. It let that command finish. Once the results were stored in the WMI property, it saw that it was, pulled the data, and here we go. And here we have it. Thanks. So we'll do two more. So we'll do this remote posh. We'll target myself. I have the script on my local system. Give me just 1 second. Let me see what I call it. Test power. And actually, let me pull up the function that we're using. Test pwn. So let's go to here. All right, we're going to tell it to run test pwn. And so what's happening is it encoded that script, stored it on the remote system, which is really just in this case, this system. Running the script, getting the output, and then displaying it. So thanks for having us at Troopers. And so finally, I think this is going to let me do it. You can do, yeah, no. You can just do basic stuff, power off, and we can shut down. So this is a tool that we've used internally for a while, and it's been really, really helpful. We haven't yet had the chance to use it against device guard systems, but we have a lot of the same capabilities that we use in a RAT that we wanted to be able to have for specifically systems protected by that. And I'll give this back to Evan.
All right. So we give everyone tools to kind of do your job in terms of red teaming, pen testing, and things like that. Nothing else outside of those bounds, obviously. And we also want to give you the tools to detect on this activity. So one of the things that WMI offers is the WMI query language, and you can use WMI versus WMI to actually catch this sort of activity, but you have to use WMI to do it. So you can create a, in our case, if you want to persist with WMI, you would essentially create your own consumer. So that's one thing to look for and something that we're looking for. And then we also want to look for WMI process executions. So that would be like if you ran WMIC process call create, for example, on a remote system, that sort of activity would be caught. And WIMI implant uses that same capability whenever it remotely connects to systems and runs processes. And so what we would do is we would create an event filter, which is a condition that would be, you know, run to perform a specific action. That action is an event consumer that would then log the details of that event, given that something was executed, for example. So in this case, the action would be create an event log, and this would be very high fidelity, so you're not going to get any false positives, with the, at least from the examples that we've had. So if you get this event log, you know something bad's really happening. And then you would, in theory, feed these event logs to a sim using Snare or Universal Forwarder, and then you can wrap alerting around these event logs. So if this event log were to trigger and actually generate, then you need to go investigate that system because someone did something malicious via WMI. Unless you just always use WMI to call processes remotely, which isn't as common, and especially not persisting a system. So how would you do that automatically? Well, we wrote this tool called WMI Monitor, and it's essentially a PowerShell script you can find in this link. And we wrote a blog post on it as well called WMI versus WMI Monitor. A lot of the research behind this was taken from Matt Graber and an IDS called Uproot, which I'll talk about in a moment. But for, I would say, non-enterprise systems, but someone who's single, has like a single laptop or a small domain, this is very scalable in a smaller environment. And what it would do is, like I said, it would generate these event logs. This one's an example of a persistence event log. So once you run the script, and anytime you persist the system via WMI, it will have this event. Say, hey, new WMI consumer was created. Again, this rarely happens for legit reasons, unless they're persisting a system. And then it will give you event data around that consumer. So what command is that consumer going to execute? In this case, payback.exe. And what is that consumer name? The next would be for command execution. So when the event triggers again, it will create an event log with the data WMI command executed, and it will actually give you the exact command that was run, which gives you enough information. Like for this case, you got what process was run. You also have an NBI, which is a network-based indicator. In this case, it's an IP address, and what payload that was actually run. So that's a lot of details for an investigator to scale an environment and find out who else got compromised. So really good data here, and again, very high fidelity. These sort of things don't happen commonly. So if you did run this script on your system and this specific event log triggered, you know something bad probably happened via WMI. So the next thing I want to talk about is Uproot IDS. This is essentially like this stuff on crack, essentially. So this is meant for maybe probably larger environments. It has way more signatures. It's got 14 signatures compared to R2. Our two signatures are the persistence ones and the process execution ones. This one has 14 total, which is a lot more than just R2. And it does include the process execution and persistence as well. So what's nice about this is it has a centralized logging system. So it literally is an IDS, so one single system as a server. And then you can install PowerShell scripts on all remote systems, and it will use HTTP and HTTPS to post back to that one system. So instead of putting a Snare agent or a Universal Forwarder on all your endpoints to log those specific event logs, you technically only have to do it on the IDS server and pull that one, you know, that one system, all the logs would go to that system, so you can just put it on that one server in terms of Snare or Universal Forwarder agents. And again, since it uses HTTP and HTTPS to post back that data, you don't technically need agents on them, you just need to run the PowerShell scripts or the installers for that IDS, which are open source. So some future work on WIMI implant, I'll let, you don't want to talk about it?
Yeah, sure. Okay.
Go ahead.
A couple different future options that we may look into is see if we can identify and start implementing some application whitelisting bypasses as they become available, and if they're useful to us on a device guard protected system, because obviously we would want to repurpose it, and if it leads to a constrained language mode bypass or anything like that for our use case. And really, I mean, the big thing is it's just, I don't know if I can give a, or we can give a specific example.
So
we just
want to. So one I'm doing is the MS Build one that he was talking about earlier. So I have a proof of concept CS proj file out there on my Git. It essentially is a shellcode injector. So if you have this CS proj file, you put your shellcode into the file, call MS Build against that file, it will execute the shellcode. In this case, anything that you want that you can generate shellcode from. And in our case, we use it a lot for Cobalt Strike's beacon. So we're going to actually port this into PowerShell and make a function that allows you to feed it any csproj file that will remotely execute against the system using msbuild, which is a pretty good application whitelisting technique that was made by SubT. He's a really good researcher in terms of application whitelisting.
Good. Excellent. All right. And that's it. The code is live as of 15 minutes ago. So it just got pushed out. And hopefully it will be useful to everyone else as it has been to us. Thank you.
All right, thank you very much. I think we have time for two questions. That was fast. Since we have the closing remarks, we need to stay some of time.
First of all, this is awesome. It's really cool.
Thank you.
But I have a question. Did you guys figure out where the data you're storing? It's in memory, so did you figure out where it's actually stored? Because if you're overwriting the string where the memory dump goes, if you get in crashing kernel mode, how does it know? Is it stored in kernel mode?
So that string is really only overwritten for, like I said, a very short period of time. If that's modified at all, like, so we obtain the original value, we then use it for storage purposes, and then immediately once we pull that data back, it's restored to its original value. So we're not.
Does this allow you to write data into kernel mode?
Not necessarily, no, because it's basically overwriting a string. I don't really know how to describe it best. It's not like we're overflowing into some other protected memory space that could cause a crash. It's just changing a variable value, essentially.
Yeah, but I was wondering.
You're wondering if it's in user land or kernel land?
Yeah.
So I will say that, like, WMI operates, you know, using system almost always. You can actually execute or create WMI classes without having system level privileges. Where that stands on the stack and, like, in terms of, you know, ring 3 to ring 0,
yeah.
I don't actually know the answer, to be honest. I don't know. But I do know it works, but I don't know if it, I know it runs a system, so maybe it is kernel mode. I don't know if it goes that low or not, though, personally.
Yeah, 265 meg of data you can store in the kernel that could give you some possibilities. You
know? Sure, yeah. I like the way your head's at.
Anyone else?
Okay, one more slightly shorter question.
All right.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much. Thank you.